Hello, I'm Jason with BigSharkTackle.com, and welcome to Bait Deployment 101, where we'll discuss some basic techniques for bait deployment for beginning land-based shark fishermen. Okay, let's get started. The first thing I want to talk about is safety. It's very important to be careful out there and to do things in a wise and smart way. Shark fishing, I think, can be a very safe thing if you use your head. If you don't, then it can be very dangerous. The first thing we need to talk about is this right here, the personal flotation device, otherwise known as the life jacket. Very, very, very important. Do not leave home without it. First time I paddled out, I got way out there experimenting, trying to figure this out, and I learned the hard way that you don't always come in with your kayak. I got out there, turned over, and got separated from my kayak. The next wave came and took my kayak with it, left me out there by myself. Fortunately, I had this, and it saved my life that day, probably. There are a number of other things that could go wrong. You could get tangled up in your line. You could get hit in the head with your kayak. There's all kinds of things that might go wrong. They usually don't, but sometimes they do, and you have to be prepared for that. So this is the most important thing to always take with you. The second thing I want to talk about is securing these right here. This is a hook, but it's also could be a weapon. And I've heard of a number of people, unfortunately, who have, in the process of paddling out their baits, have turned over and gotten impaled on their hook one way or another, in the neck or in the leg. And this is a large hook that we use, and you do not want to get one stuck in you. That means a trip to the emergency room, probably surgery to remove it, and that is not conducive to fishing, and therefore we don't like that. So, a couple of ideas on how to keep these from getting together with you and your body. The first, this right here is the best idea I've heard of for securing a bait and hook. Take a little cooler, strap it down to the back of your kayak, securely put your bait and your hooks inside the cooler, close your cooler, get you a bungee, the bungee about down nice and tight so that it will not come off if you turn over, and that way if you turn over you know that that hook is not going to get you. So that's the best and the most secure way I've heard of doing it, and it's worked good for me and people I know. So that would be my first suggestion. Second suggestion is what I have here is just a little rubber stopper. We sell these on the website. It's just almost like a little cork made out of rubber, but it has a hole drilled through the middle of it. And it works pretty good for sticking on the barb of a hook. So if you don't have a cooler and you want some other way to keep your barbs protected and keep you protected from your barbs, you can get one of these and put it on there, or just at the hardware store you can buy these as well. The ones at our hardware stores here don't have holes in them, but you can put a hole in it and hook it onto your seat or whatever on your kayak when you're paddling out, and that'll give you some degree of protection. Not as secure as the cooler, because these can fall off, but it's a lot better than nothing. Next safety item I want to discuss is a knife and pliers. This is a diving knife. Has a little button you push here and the knife can come out. It's got a little edge here for cutting fishing line or anything like that. It's also got a regular edge, and these nice little scabbards, you can attach it to your life jacket and have it really handy in the event of an emergency where you get tangled up in your line, or for some reason you need to cut something quickly to get out of danger. So that's one suggestion. Another would be to bring wire cutters with you in a pocket in your life jacket, maybe. Whatever works to keep lines off you if you do get tangled up. I've personally never gotten tangled up in lines, but when you take a spill out there, you don't know what end is up for a few seconds there, and you don't know where your kayak is, you don't know where your line is. You're at the mercy of the currents, and it's a very real possibility that somewhere in there you could get tangled up in your line, and you need to be able to swim, and if you're tangled up in your line, you can't do that. And so this is good to have in a case of emergency. Okay, one last safety item, and this is just something to remember, especially when you're in the shallow water. don't stand in between your kayak and the beach. You would be amazed, and I am still amazed, at the power with which a small wave can grab a kayak and carry it with it. And it's almost like a bulldozer coming through there. And if you're standing in shallow water and a wave comes and carries that kayak into your leg, I haven't heard of it, but it would not surprise me a bit. It could tear up your knee, bust a leg, I don't know. But it is just amazing the power with which just a small wave can carry a kayak. So when you're trying to get in, or you're just trying to bring your kayak up and down the beach or something, stay on the ocean or sea side of the kayak, not on the beach side, because the waves will carry it and just whack it right into you. And that's something that could just be a really simple way to ruin a trip pretty quick. Okay, well, that takes care of the safety issues. Let's talk about the actual techniques of paddling out. The first rule or first guideline is to make sure that you've always got the pointy end of your kayak pointing straight into the waves. You want to try to avoid getting sideways, because that's when you end up getting spilled and turned over and starting all over again. So try to keep that nose end pointed into the waves. Another very important thing, and this is something I learned the hard way, was continue paddling through the wave. It's a tendency maybe for a beginner to stop and wait for that wave to go by and make sure everything's okay. However, if you catch the right kind of wave, one that's just broken, a lot of foam and white water on top, you'll kind of sink down into that as you go through it, because the buoyancy is less with all the air in the water for the kayak, so it'll ride a little lower through the wave, and it'll have a tendency to take you with it and just suck you up and get you surfing backwards. And that always ends in you spilling and turning over. So you want to keep paddling through the wave so it doesn't take you with it and reverse your progress. So keep pointing in the waves, paddle through them. Another thing that you need to keep an eye out for, be aware of, is if you catch a larger wave right as it's breaking, you end up having to go over like a wall of water, and if you're in a shorter kayak, it can flip you backwards. Longer kayaks, it's not as much of an issue for, but any kayak, say 10 feet and under, you're going to want to be aware of that issue. And if you do catch a wave right as it's going over, you want to lean forward and try to punch through the wave a bit so you don't have it carry you backwards. Also, on some of the kayaks that I have one that my first one I bought wasn't really made for in the surf, and it had a tendency to punch through the waves because it had a really pointy front end, and it would go through a wave instead of over. And I learned that if you catch a wave that's already broken, got a lot of foam coming at you, I'll try to lean back on the kayak and let that front end kind of take a little weight off that front end, which allows it to get up and over that wave a little bit easier. And that helps you, because if you go through the wave, you end up getting water over the bow and into the kayak, which makes you ride that much lower until it's able to drain out through the scupper holes. And that slows you down a lot. And so anything you can do as the waves hit you to keep water from coming up over the bow is a good thing, because that just slows you down that much more. So anyway, but once you get out, paddle through the breakers. In some places that'll just be one set of breakers, some places that'll be two or three. In Texas here, we tend to have three bars that you have to get over. And on your average day, it's rough enough that they're breaking on all three bars. But once you get past the bars, you just turn around, get to a place where you can have a minute or two to untangle your line if necessary, and drop everything over in the right order so it doesn't get tangled up down there. What we usually do is get our paddle and signal to the person on the beach who's watching our line or watching our rod and reel. Just wave our paddle so they'll know that they've dropped the bait, that you've dropped the bait, and that they can close the bail and tighten down the drag and get the rod ready for that shark that comes along. So then head back in. Getting back in, there's a couple ways of doing it. You can try to surf in. That's easier with the shorter one and harder with the longer kayak. And it takes some technique, and it's a whole different ballgame. But that's one way in, trying to surf it in. Another way that's, for me, a little more of a surefire thing is sometimes I'll just go in backwards. And as each wave hits, each of the larger waves, I'll just paddle into it a little bit to make sure it doesn't take me with it and have a little control. And I'll paddle backwards a little bit and then paddle into the next wave and just kind of work my way in that way. And that's the safe way in. If you've got something in your kayak you're trying to do, you don't want to take a spill, then you can do that. If you want to try to have a little fun and be a little more daring, you can try to surf it in. But that takes a lot of practice and technique to figure that one out. And you got to have the right kind of kayak too. Again, it'd need to be a shorter kayak with a flared front end, instead of a longer one with a pointy front end. That just doesn't work at all. I found that out the hard way as well. So that's the basics on bait deployment. And if you like this and you thought it helped you, then you might check out Bait Deployment 202, which is going to be the second installment of this little series. And hopefully this will help you to be able to have a better first fishing trip and not have to waste as much time as I did learning all these things the hard way.